to the world the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the earth, the Savior's reign, and men their song employ. While fields and floods, rock hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy. And wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Come on, let's give God some praise this morning. We thank the Lord and we give God all the praise, the glory and the honor due God's name. We thank God and we bless him. I'm going to ask if Sister Karen would come and Deacon Karen would come and light the candles. You're going to light every candle except the Christ candle in the middle. And I'm going to read as we celebrate love today on this fourth Sunday in Advent. Let's give God some praise and glory and honor due God's name. We thank the Lord and we just bless him today. The Lord is worthy, 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 worthy to be praised. Amen. Amen. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I'm a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and knowledge, and I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things. Love believes all things. Love hopes all things. Love endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part. We prophesy only in part, but when the complete comes, love, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in the mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, and the greatest of these is love. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you, God, and we give you glory and honor. We thank you, Lord, that there is none like you. We thank you, God, that you are the glory and the lifter of our heads. God, we thank you for this time of worship this morning. We thank you for those who are watching on Facebook and YouTube and our website, those that are watching on Instagram Live, and we give you praise and glory. Now, Lord, let everything that we do today in this worship service be as worship unto you. Let every song that is sang be worship unto you. Every prayer that is prayed, every scripture read, every word preached, let the camera person and the musicians and those outside making sure we're safe. Sister Loretta, as she's downstairs receiving the food for the food pantries and the gifts given to families, let everything that we do be as worship unto you. And so, God, we say, have your way today. Let your anointing flow. Let your power fall and your fire fall. We thank you, God, and we give you praise. We lift up your name today. Thy name be lifted up above all the earth. We thank you, God, and we bless you. We bless you, Lord, and we thank you. Now, Lord, have your way. Let your healing anointing flow. It is in the strong name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Come on and give God some praise. Amen.
Oh, come let us There is nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope.
Your presence, Lord.
I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free. My shame is undone.
Your presence, Lord,
Holy Spirit,
you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome. Your presence, Lord.
Your presence, Lord.
Holy Spirit.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope.
Your presence.
I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone.
Your presence, Lord,
Holy Spirit,
Holy Spirit,
you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill me. Experience the glory of your goodness.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence.
Let us experience
the glory of your goodness. Your presence, Lord.
Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for.
To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Spirit. You are welcome here. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Help me out, Zion. Come fill
with your atmosphere.
Come, glory, guide our hearts, Lord, for to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
I just want you to lift your hands wherever you are. And I just want you to reverence the Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Spirit. We can do nothing without the Holy Spirit. We exalt the name of the Lord and we call on the Holy Spirit. Come on, if you're watching online, just lift your hands. If you're not driving, if you're home in a safe place, just worship, 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 worship. You're going to hear me talking about worship all year in 2021. Worship, worship, worship. Worship, 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 worship. Your presence, Lord. Come on, help me out, y'all. Come on. No time to get shy now. We worshiping. Very softly worship. Dear Lord, we thank you for your presence in this place. Holy Spirit, fill us with your presence. Take us outside of ourselves. Arrest our attention where we will be able to do nothing but to focus on you. We pause right now in your presence, God, and we say, Lord, have your way. Holy Spirit, have your way. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. We thank you, Lord, and we bless your name today. We bow down in your presence, Lord. We humble ourselves in your presence. We humble ourselves in your presence. And we say, Lord, have your way. Have your way, Lord. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's give God another hand clap of praise. You know, worship is one of the most important things. It's just, I mean, I must call me old-fashioned, but I don't know how you can sit down when worship is going on. I don't know how you can pour juice and And I don't know how you could do it. I don't. When I hear worship, and I hear the sound of the Lord, I freeze, I pause, because there's nothing more important than giving God your full attention in worship. There's nothing more important than that. And when you're in tune with the Spirit, God has a way of pausing you where you just can't move. You just can't do anything. You got to lift your hands. You got to lay on the floor. You got to get on your knees. You got to bow your head. You got to do something, because the presence of the Lord is near. And so we thank the Lord for worship today. And we give God glory in Jesus' name. Come on, put your hands together. Let's give God some praise. Thank you, Sister Melinda. Thank you all. Thank all of you. We praise the Lord. And we give God glory and praise and honor. Do God's name. Hallelujah. I'm so glad and so thankful. Listen, if you're watching online, you still have time to get here and drop off your items for the families that we are going to support this year. Every year, we support families at Live Well Church, and we'll also be making donations to the food bank here. So please, if you're in the area, if you're watching online and you have some non-perishables, some food you want to give, some support, a seed, Sister Loretta is downstairs preparing the boxes and the packages, and we just thank the Lord and we give God praise and glory and honor. Do God's name. Amen. Amen. We thank the Lord. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1, starting at verse 18. We thank God and we give God praise. Had a wonderful time with the men of Berean Baptist Church of Brooklyn and Raleigh this morning via Zoom. And so I've been preaching since 8 o'clock this morning and praying, and I'm just so grateful. I feel like God is going to do something wonderful for us, and God is going to lift us up. We're so grateful to God for all that God is doing. Amen. We give God glory and praise and honor. Do God's name. Join Live Well Church and the praise team this Thursday at 6:30 p.m. for our Christmas Eve service. I'm so looking forward to our praise team singing us into glory. They sounded wonderful. Give them a hand clap of praise. We thank the Lord for them. Amen. I wanted them just to keep on singing. Keep on singing. Amen. But they'll be leading us in worship on this Thursday, and we'll have a Christmas message for you. And so we thank the Lord and we give God praise. I see all of you online, Mother Long and Dr. Joan and Mother Jackson and Sister Deb, Deacon Deb, and all of you. Thank the Lord for watching and participating in the service online. We will get through this together. I know it can be difficult, but we will make it through this together. Amen. Someone once said, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. And I believe that Live Well Church is going to go far because we are going to stay together. We're going to keep moving forward. We're going to keep growing and learning and allowing God to lift us up. Amen. And so we thank the Lord today. We thank God. We thank God today. Amen. Amen. Matthew chapter 1, starting at verse 18. Now the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. I told you, the Holy Spirit is powerful. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. I want you to tag that in your text. Joseph had a plan to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, he made a New Year's resolution. An angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son. I love it when God sends messages like, you will do this. You will go forward. You will get the job. You will move forward. You will have peace. You will be healed. you will have a fruitful marriage. The church will grow. Oh my God. You will overcome. I love that. I love that. The angel declared, she will bear a son. And you are to name him Jesus. For he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. When Joseph woke from his sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but he had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. Proverbs 16:9, in their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their plans. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your word today. We give you glory and honor to your name. We thank you, Lord, that you are God and there is none like you. Now let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. It is in the strong name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. You may be seated in his presence. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. Let's give God a hand clap of praise as we go to our seats. Thank you, Zion and Zachary. Thank you. We praise the Lord. I'll be speaking to you briefly at peace with God's plan. At peace with God's plan. You know, I've already started planning for 2021 and beyond. Every year, starting at Thanksgiving, it's a time of self-reflection for me, Sister Melinda. I begin to just think of all the things that God wants to do. And I begin to put a plan in place, not just for my life, but the life of the church, and seeing and listening to what God wants us to do. Many of you know that our theme for 2021 at Live Well Church is prioritizing the kingdom, prioritizing the kingdom. Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things that you're worried about, and all these things that you're running after, and all these things that you desire, all these different things that's driving you crazy, they'll be added onto your life. Don't worry. But seek first the kingdom of God. That's a wonderful command, isn't it? And we've skipped some steps. We've skipped some steps. And so we're going to go back and start again and put first things first, seeking the kingdom first. The kingdom before preaching, the kingdom before singing, the kingdom before this, the kingdom before that, putting the kingdom first. And all these things will be added onto you. The Holy Spirit will be added onto you when you seek the kingdom first. You have to make it up and conjure it up and do all these spiritual acrobatics. You know, this Holy Spirit will be given to you. And so we have a plan for 20 and 21. Why do I keep saying that? 2021. Amen. 2021. We have a plan and beyond. Amen. I am hopeful that this pandemic will be over in 2021 and we will be able to put this behind us. This pandemic. It's been a terrible year. 300,000 lives lost. 55% of businesses, maybe 75% of African American businesses, will not reopen. Families have been devastated. There are empty chairs at the table this year during Christmas. We just don't know exact. Churches have closed. It's been a difficult time, to say the least. And as we look ahead and mourn those who have lost their lives, and as we help those, remember, we're blessed to be a blessing. As we help those who need a hand up, not just a hand out, but a hand up. And we help those get back on their feet. And Lord have mercy, we even start to gather at church again. I can't wait till we get start to gather at church again and everybody is here and the pews are filled and the church is doing work in the community and we're here connecting and worshiping and praying and preaching. I don't know about you, but I cannot wait until the doors of the church building reopens again. Now, the church is open, but the building is closed. The church is open, but the building is closed. And I can't wait in 2021. I can't wait till we start gathering again. And like many others, Sister Yvette, I've resolved to execute this plan. I made resolutions. Many of you have made some resolutions. Have some of you made some resolutions for 2021? I know that many people are. At the fitness doctor, people are coming telling me they're not going to eat cake anymore. That's a lie. They're telling me that they're not going to eat cookies anymore. That's a lie. They're telling me they're not going to eat fast food anymore. That's a lie. But they've made all these resolutions. But I have resolved, and perhaps you have resolved, to execute your plan. Amen? To execute your plan. And one of my plan, I have a plan. Now, I want you to listen to this now. Maybe you can use it as an example for yourself, as a template. I have a plan for my family. You know, my family. I have a plan for my family. I already told you I have a plan for my church family, but I have a plan for my family, my wife, my children. I have a plan. We have a plan in place. We have a plan to prioritize my faith as it pertains to the kingdom. We said we're going to do that, right? I'm going to prioritize the kingdom. I'm going to prioritize my faith. That means my faith is first. That means the kingdom first over everything. So I'm prioritizing my faith. That's my plan. I have a sound financial plan in place as it pertains to giving. I already have my my tithes and my offering are coming out automatically, and we've even upped it. We made it so we have a plan in place for our giving. There's people that I'm looking to give things to and give shoes to and clothes to and different things to. I'm looking to give people and help them pay their rent and help. I'm looking to give this year. I want to give because I'm blessed to be a blessing. I have a plan in place for my giving. Can't wait to give for Mary's house. Can't wait. It's going to be a wonderful time. And I have a plan also, Brother Mark, to improve my physical fitness and health. That's right. The fitness doctor can improve because you never arrive. You never arrive. You never get to this place where you're just walking around like Zeus and you're just built up and you got it all together. You never arrive. You never arrive physically in your physical fitness and health, and you never arrive spiritually. Please don't ever think you arrive spiritually, that you just attain this nirvana, this place of actual self-actualization and this place of bliss where you've just arrived in your spirituality and you don't have to learn anything else and nobody can tell you anything. Nobody can tell you how to worship. Nobody can tell you how to praise. Nobody can tell you how to go higher spiritually. You never arrive. We never arrive. We just keep growing and growing. Like a forest. No, that's LL Cool J. We just keep growing and growing and glowing and moving. Amen? We never arrive. We never arrive. I have a plan. Physical fitness and health. Can I share my plan with you? Just really quick. Can I? Maybe you will incorporate it into your plan. Amen? First, I want you to find a good physician and get a thorough physical. That's important. Colonoscopy, I have to take one this year. Prostate screening, men. Mammogram, women. Full thorough physical. And if your doctor does not want to give you a thorough physical, find you another doctor. We get you a thorough physical. That's the first thing you do. Then next, I want you to learn how to lift weights and incorporate weightlifting, strength training into your routine. No matter how young or old you are, you must lift weights. You must learn how to lift weights. It's okay, D. You must learn how to lift weights, okay? So you got to lift weights. You got to incorporate that. You got to learn how to do it. I want you to walk or jog at least 3 miles, 3 to 4 days a week. Get out there and walk and jog 3 miles, 3 to 4 days per week. I want you to drink 8 glasses of water per day. If you're over 50, start drinking that water at 4 p.m. Well, it's going to be a long night for you. Amen. I want you to strengthen your core. That means I want you to strengthen up your abdominal muscles and your lower back muscles. And I want you to get those muscles strong because as we get older, we need our core muscles to move. We need them to climb. We need them to walk upstairs. We need them to reach. We need them to pick up our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren. We need them to wash our cars when we're 85. We need them to do gardening. We need our core muscles. So I want you to strengthen your core. I want you to eat more vegetables and limit your carbs. You know, I want you to have more vegetables on your plate than more carbs. Piece of nice baked chicken and some broccoli, a full plate of broccoli. Do you know that you can eat as much broccoli as you like? You can just pile up your plate full of broccoli and get full off broccoli instead of mashed potatoes. Get full off broccoli instead of French fries. You understand? I want you to limit your carbs. I want you to get at least 8 hours of sleep. These are things that we can plan for. 8 hours of sleep. Nothing like some good sleep. I can tell that I'm getting older. I get home and I start thinking about my bed for sleep. Amen. It's 5:30. I'm like, couple more hours. Nothing like getting 8 hours of good sleep. I want you to meditate and pray. I know that you're praying. We Live Well Church. We're a praying church. We have a prayer call, but I also want you to meditate. I want you to get quiet. I want you to learn something called contemplative prayer. Contemplative prayer is when you just sit quietly before the Lord. You sit quietly in your car, quietly at the park, quietly in your room, quietly in your closet, wherever you pray, in your basement, wherever you pray. Just sit quietly and let God speak to you and write down what God is saying to you. That's contemplative prayer. Actually, that is the actual real way of praying. Prayer is not a monologue. It's a dialogue. And you should be listening to what God is speaking to your spirit and writing it down. And you do that by getting quiet. The Bible says, be still and know that I'm God. God reminds us in the Bible that he's not in the fire, the earthquake, the big thunderous choir and all of that. But he is in the still, small voice. God, meditate, take a yoga class. You know, Christians were so afraid of yoga for many years. Foolishness. Take you a yoga class and learn how to stretch. You got to be flexible. You got to be able to be flexible, and you want to learn how to stretch. And finally, get rid of sugar. Yeah, I saved that for last. Get rid of white sugar. Eliminate it. Can I just have a little bit? No. Eliminate it from your diet. It's not easy. But we're going to try this together. And we're going to start on January 4th when we start our fast for 21 days. You understand? We're going to do this together. And then we're going to try to keep it going throughout the year. We're going to try our best. We're going to put it before the Lord. And we're going to ask the Lord to help us. Amen? Amen. Nothing like a plan. Nothing like a man with a plan, and nothing like a woman with a plan. Nothing like a person with a plan. But the only thing that is better than a plan, the only thing that is better than a man with a plan or a woman with a plan, is a man or woman with a God-ordained plan. Y'all hear me? Not your plan, not the plan that someone else has for you, but a God-ordained plan for your life. Prioritizing the kingdom is a God-ordained plan for our Live Well family. You understand? But you also can have a God-ordained plan for your personal life. God gave it to you. It's a God-ordained plan. And it has to be given to you by God. Joseph was a man with a God-ordained plan. And not only was his plan God-ordained, Joseph was at peace with God's plan. Oh, it's so important, y'all. You can't just have a God-ordained plan and receive it. You got to receive it and be at peace with the plan. You got to be at peace with it, whatever it might be. Whatever it is. If God gave it to you, you got to be at peace with it. You got to be at peace with God's ordained plan. I told you many years ago when my wife and I, we were going through all these financial issues and we were losing our home and the modification would not go through, wouldn't go through. And I talked to the final bank person and they laughed at me. I couldn't believe it. Nothing but the devil. And when I finished talking to them, they said, we can't give you the modification. We're not going to give it to you. I said, okay, I didn't get upset. I didn't talk about their mother, their uncle. I didn't get mad. I just simply said okay, and put the phone down, and was at peace with God's plan. I said, this is God's plan. This is God working. I went in the house, said, pack your stuff. We leaving. Went and got a townhouse, moved into that. God's plan. And God worked in that plan. Didn't he, First Lady? He worked all in it. Well, y'all know the story. Things turned around, and we were able to move back into our home about a year later. But we were at peace with that plan when it was going on. We had surrendered it to God. We gave it up to God. We didn't worry about what was going to happen. We just said, if this is happening, if God is allowing it to happen, it is part of God's ordained plan for our life. And it sure was, because it taught us a lot. Taught us a lot. Joseph received a God-ordained plan. You know, I like Joseph. I like Joseph because he's not talked about much in the Bible, but he has a very important role within the Bible. I like Joseph. I like many in the Bible. I have many heroes in the Bible. I have Abraham. I like Abram because he went to the unfamiliar. I like King David because he was a man after God's own heart. I like King Asa because he tore down the high places and restored worship in Israel. Oh my God! I love Samuel the prophet. I love so many people. I love Abigail. I love Deborah in the Bible. I love Ruth. I love all these people in the Bible. What's the woman that I love so much in the Book of Acts? Lydia. I love it. Lydia. In the Bible, I love her. I love Jesus. He's probably my biggest hero ever within the Bible. Jesus. But I also like Joseph. Because Joseph was often overlooked and sometimes ridiculed, Mark, because his bride told him an incredible tale. And he believed it. Not because Joseph was a fool in this year, but because he was obedient. Don't you know that sometimes when God has a plan for your life and God has an ordained plan for his life, people will ridicule you because of it. People will tell you that you're foolish, that it doesn't make sense, that how can you believe that Jesus wasn't God, and that how can you say that this man is God? And they'll ridicule you because you're praying to an immaterial God that you cannot see. They'll ridicule you because you're getting out of bed on Sunday morning while they're home washing their boat or preparing to go play golf and you're sitting up in church. They'll ridicule you because you want to worship the Lord and you want to play songs for the Lord and you want to call on the name of the Lord and you're praying and believing and trusting in a God, and they'll tell you get off your knees and stop praying and get up and go to work. They'll tell you that it doesn't make sense. They'll ridicule you because of God's ordained plan for your life. You're crazy for giving 10% of your salary. Crazy for offering. Crazy. But yet they give 10% of their salary to secular things. They give 10% of their salary to drugs and alcohol. They give 10% of their salary to the casino. They give 10% of their salary to pornography. They give 10% of their salary to having a woman on the side. They give 10% of their salary to going over to Las Vegas. They give 10% of their salary, but we're crazy because we're giving to an immaterial God. And just like Joseph, we were ridiculed. Joseph was ridiculed. He was ridiculed because he believed his bride. Joseph was a righteous man. I like him, Deke, because he was a righteous man. He was a good man. Nothing wrong with being a good man. Nothing wrong with being a good woman. Just righteous and good and kind and loving. He was a good man. He reminds us that even if you're good, though, even if you're good and you're doing everything right and you're going to church and you're doing all these different things and you're leading the praise team and all these things that you're doing that are good, you can still have shameful circumstances in your life. We were doing everything right, serving God, building up the church, and we still had this shameful circumstance. Our neighbors had to watch us move out of our house. I could hear them, "Where's your God now?" Shameful. You can still be good and do everything right and still have some shameful circumstances in your life. The situation with Mary was shameful. Shameful, y'all. And the Bible is such a living text. It's just a wonderful book of instruction and spiritual principles. Joseph God brought his son on the earth through a shameful situation. Perhaps God wants to work mightily in your shameful situation. Yeah. We're always in church trying to hide our stuff, trying to act like we're perfect and we got it all together. But perhaps God wants to work, do his best work in your shameful situation, in the thing that you would dare not expose. Perhaps God wants to work in that. Joseph's bride was bringing shame to the family name. You know the story. Joseph and Mary were betrothed. They were engaged to be married. Betrothal was a signed, sealed, and delivered deal of marriage. You were already married, even though you were engaged, and it was going to happen. And it was during this time that Joseph learned that his bride, Mary, was with child. And the story gets worse. Not only was she with child, she wouldn't even tell him who it was. She wouldn't even say his name. All Joseph wanted to hear was, who was it? Was it David? Was it Alan? Was it Tariq? Who was it? Who was the person that did this and brought this shame on our family? And all she could say, you know, Joseph, all she could say was it was conceived of the Holy Spirit. I don't know what cuts worse, being lied to or somebody telling you an incredible tale about the lie. She said it was conceived. This child that I'm carrying, Joseph, now it's not yours, but don't worry, it's not Tariq's either. It's the Holy Spirit. Don't worry, it's not Billy's, it's not David, it's not the guy that I was with at work. It's not that. It's the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit did this. And Joseph had to believe her. This is too much. Joseph couldn't have. See, sometimes you're in life, even though you're a good person, things can just be overwhelming. When people that are close to you are hiding things from you, when you feel like you're being lied to, and you feel like you've done everything right and you're still finding yourself in shameful circumstances, it can be overwhelming. Joseph was overwhelmed. It's too much. Doing everything right. Everybody knows this. So Joseph devised a plan. It wasn't a God-ordained plan, but it was a plan dipped in righteousness. I want y'all to hear me. Just because you devise a plan that seems good doesn't mean that it's God good. Just because you come up with a plan that seems or appears good doesn't mean it's God good. Oh, my God. Joseph devised a plan because he was a good man. But it wasn't a God-ordained plan. It was a plan dipped in righteousness. Joseph was going to end the engagement in a righteous manner. He was planning to do it secretly. It was a plan dipped in righteousness. You know what I'm saying, Belinda? In other words, he was going to say, okay, I can't marry her, but I got to get out of this. So instead of telling the whole village why I'm dumping her and why I'm getting rid of her, I'm just going to put her away secretly. I'm going to say she didn't like me anymore. I'm going to say she changed her mind. I'm going to just leave it so people can kind of come up with their own narrative. Put her away secretly. Good man with a good plan, but not a God plan. You know, some of us have come up with some good plans, but but not God plans. Yeah. You want to take that promotion on your job, but it pulls you away from your purpose. Your purpose of being a servant, your purpose of being in God's will. You're going to make some more money. You're going to be able to take care of your family, be able to give to your church. It's a good plan, but it may not be a God plan. Yeah. Remember speaking to a young man about, this is a young man about my age, a few months ago, maybe a month ago, just lost his mother. He was a teacher of a school in Mississippi. And he shared with me that he got an opportunity to move beyond that school and go to a better school up north and teach math. Yeah. But he said while he was describing his life in Mississippi, and his wife was a top executive, black couple. And he got this opportunity. While he was in this school in Mississippi, he was so on purpose dealing in this impoverished community. He said that him and the principal, they got together and bought laundromats and washing machines to the school so the children can have a place to wash their clothes. He said he was so on purpose that he taught and he went to jails and he talked to the kids, and four or five of his kids in his class were murdered. And he was there on purpose. But then he got a call for the promotion and he left. But I can tell, he didn't say it, but I can tell that he went for the promotion, which was good, but maybe not God. Oh, my God. Joseph decided something that was good, but God had a better plan for his life. Even when we have a plan, listen to me, and we're almost done. Even when we have a plan of our own, or we have resolved to execute our own plan, we as men and women of God, we must remain open and consider that God has an alternative, perhaps better plan. Y'all hear me? You got to remain open. You got to consider God. You got to put God into the equation. You got to say, maybe God has something even better. This is a shameful circumstance. I don't know how we're going to make it out of this. I don't know how we're going to overcome. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know how we're going to go forward, but I'm just going to pause and I'm going to be still and I'm going to wait on the Lord. For those that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not faint. They shall walk and not grow weary. I'm just going to wait on the Lord and see what God is going to do. I know that I already got my shoes on and my coat on and I'm ready to go and execute my plan. Hold on, Zion. I'm going to go execute my plan, but I'm just going to wait on the Lord for a moment. I'm going to wait on the Lord. I'm going to wait on the Lord because I know God has a better plan than what I've devised and what I've came up with and what I've dreamed and schemed about. So I'm just going to wait on the Lord. I'm going to let God work it out. I'm going to let God tell me when to make the call. I'm going to let God tell me when to put in the resume. I'm going to let God tell me when to get back to school. I'm going to let God tell me what to do about this illness. I'm going to let God tell me how to work it out with my child. I'm going to let God give me a God-ordained plan. A God-ordained plan. Yeah, a God-ordained plan. All right. We must consider God's plan. Got 3 points for you. We're done. First point is we must consider God's plan like Joseph did. Pause and consider God's plan like Joseph did, because within God's plan is great purpose. Within God's plan is great purpose. I understand that this was written about Joseph, but I believe it was written for us. Romans 15 and 4 says, for everything that was written in the past, listen, was written to teach us that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. In other words, it wasn't written to us, but it was written for us. It was written for us to look at the life of Joseph and glean some spiritual principles from what he went through and see if we can make it relevant and applicable to our life. Yeah. God's great plan brings about God's purpose. Matthew 1, 20 and 21. But Jesus, when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Joseph was given the great purpose in God's plan to raise God's son, Jesus, to take a child that wasn't his and raise that child up, instill wisdom into that child. The Bible talks about the wisdom of Jesus. And many scholars and theologians believe that that wisdom came from Joseph. That Joseph, a simple carpenter, simple worker, God used to raise up Jesus and to bring him to where he needed to be. I told you that when you execute and accept God's plan, you will find great purpose. Oh my God, we did an assessment on Bible study the other night. How many of you like that assessment? I'm getting so many texts and calls about that assessment, and people saying, I want to know my purpose in life, because someone once said the best 2 days of your life are when you were born and when you find out why you were born. And so to know that you have a purpose that is great and that is part of God's plan, that's going to give you an energy that you can't make up. That's going to give you confidence that you can, whenever times get rough and hard, you can always lean on your purpose. I can't tell you. The only thing that kept me while we were moving forward and going through difficult times is because I knew that I was in God's plan. I knew that God had gave me a purpose, that God had called me to build up the church, that God had called me to do the impossible, that God had called me to save souls, that God had called me to preach the gospel, that God had called me to read his word, that God had called me to teach on Bible study, that God had called me to find a church. It was only when I accepted God's plan that I was able to relax on God's purpose. Joseph was able to relax within God's plan, and he found great purpose. Come on and give God some praise. Hallelujah. Secondly, great purpose. You have great purpose when you get in God's plan. You better know God's plan. You have great purpose. You won't have to guess what you're supposed to be doing, because you'll be doing it. You won't be fantasizing about it. You know, some people fantasize, some people hypothesize, but others actualize. And when you get God's plan, oh my God, you're going to actualize, you're going to get involved, you're going to do it. Joseph was doing God's plan, and he received great purpose. And then next, with God's great plan, come God's promises. Got his purpose. When you get in God's plan, you're going to get some promises. Matthew 1 and 22 and 23. All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. What a promise. What a promise. When God gives a plan, Yvette, you know this, he gives a prophetic promise to encourage you. God doesn't give you a plan without a prophetic promise. You understand? Pastor Galil, I want you to go and start a church. That's my plan. Here's my promise. I'm with you. Pastor Galil, I want you to go and I want you to keep going forward. It's going to get tough. I want you to go to school. I want you to go to church. And I want you to run your business. This is what I want you to do. And here's the promise. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You understand? Pastor Galil, I want you to go forward, and I'm calling you to do all these things. I'm going to bless you coming in, and I'm going to bless you coming out, and I'm going to lift you up, and I'm going to do some wonderful things in your life. I got a plan for you, Pastor Carmichael, and here is a prophetic promise. I'll never forget. I was home one day, and I was writing down about Live Well Church, and I was writing it out and putting a PowerPoint together and talking about and writing down everything that the Lord was giving me, and it was becoming overwhelming, and I was like, oh my God. And then I received a call from my auntie. I'll never forget my auntie. She's in heaven now, Aunt Vet. She's in heaven now. And she said, I just called with a prophetic promise for you. I said, what is it, auntie? She said, the Lord told me to tell you Isaiah 41 and 10. This is your life script, one of your life scriptures. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will uphold you. I will strengthen you with my righteous right hand. That's a prophetic promise from the Lord, and I stand on it today. Whenever things get tough and enemies are coming against me and it feels like I'm not going to make it, I remember God's word, and I say, fear not, for God is with me. When we were moving out of our house and we were going to that townhouse, I said, fear not, for God is with me. When I went back to school and I was stuck on the George Washington Bridge and I was late for class and the bill collectors were calling me while I was in the car and I broke down crying, I heard that prophetic promise say, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I know if God gave you a plan, if God gave you a plan, if God gave you a plan to go forward, if God gave you a plan in your family, in your faith, in your finances, your physical fitness and health, you can back that up with a prophetic promise. Joseph, the angel told Joseph, this is a promise. The virgin will conceive. Oh my God, it was so good. It was so good. It was so good. Oh my God, thank you, Holy Spirit. It was so good. Guess what the promise held in it for Joseph? It encouraged him that Mary wasn't lying. He said, the virgin, your wife is still a virgin. I know you thought it was Tariq, but she's a virgin. I know you thought she had a relationship with somebody else, but I'm here today to tell you from God that your wife is a virgin. Oh my God, the prophetic promises that God gives will encourage you and bring peace to your soul. Finally, and I'm done, finally, with God's great plan is the perfect solution to your problems. You hear that? I got to take my time with that. I know. We're ready to go. God's plan withholds the solution to your perfect. When you close those doors, son. God's plan. Y'all hear me? God's plan. You got to get in God's plan, his ordained plan. You got to put down your good, righteously dipped plan, your little perfect plan that you schemed and put together, that you stayed up all night on the computer right now. Put that away. Anyway, submit it to God. Submit it to God. The Bible says that a man or woman devises in their heart or plans in their heart, but it is God who orders their steps. So you making all these plans. Keep planning, but leave space for God, because in it is your perfect solution. Your perfect solution is there. It's in it. Okay. Verse 138 and 8, my favorite song. It says, the Lord will perfect those things that concern you. That's my favorite song. Favorite verse. One of my life verses. The Lord will perfect those things that concern you. I want you to take a moment and think of all those things that concern you. Just take a moment, church. Close your eyes. Just take a moment. Think of all those things that concern you. The Bible tells us and reminds us and teaches us that the Lord will perfect all those things that concern you. It's substantiated here with Joseph. Matthew 1, 24 and 25. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her, Mary, as his wife, but he had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. The Lord took this shameful situation and he smoothed it out. He said, first I'm going to encourage you, Joseph. She's a virgin. Don't worry. Take her as your wife. Marry her. The child's going to be called Jesus. I'm going to perfect all this thing that's concerning you. If you just stay with my plan, it's going to work out. I know my plan seems crazy, impossible, ridiculous. I know it's causing you ridicule, but stay with it. 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 You know, I told you that we moved into a townhouse and we moved back a year later. Time and time again, I've seen God perfect those things that concern us. I told you my story, how I came up and my family divorced and I didn't have any type of guidance from 13 all the way to 26. Do you know that's why I have so much compassion for children, young men and young women who don't have guidance from that age, because that is their formative years? That is the year. Don't you know, Dr. Kim and Sister Yvette and Sister Melinda, I was telling you the other day, we are miracles. We're miracles that made it with all we've gone through and to have made it. All of us in here. And without that support and that security and that love and that affirmation, and we still made it. 16 to 26 didn't have that, and I have all the residual of an undisciplined life at that age, of a young man with an undisciplined life. And when I came to myself and realized who I was, I looked back and saw all that devastation. And I didn't know how the Lord was going to fix that, those shameful circumstances. Don't you know, when I got in God's plan, not only did he fix family, not only did he fix my faith, not only did he fix my finances, not only did he fix me, but do you know that he just began to perfect all those things that concerned me. I had dropped out of college when I was 21. He sent me back. I went to NYU. He made ways for me, opened up doors for me. Went to New York Theological Seminary, and on and on and on. You know what God has done. I can't stop telling it. But I want you to look at that example and see how God will perfect those things that concern you. He has a perfect solution for your concern. You would just stay in this plan. Stay in this plan. I'm going to ask the praise team to come as I just finish here today. Perfect solution. God has a perfect solution. Joseph took this plan that God gave him and he found his purpose. He received great promises. God gave him a perfect solution. And it was all contingent on one thing, y'all, that he had peace with God's plan. Philippians 4:6 says, be anxious for nothing, but by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, the peace of God will be with you. Amen. The peace that surpasses all understanding will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. God will be with you. Well, what am I saying? You got to be at peace with God's plan. It might look different than your plan. It may not be what you expected. It may not have been what you wanted to do. But you have to be at peace with God's plan. Because when you're at peace, there will be provision. And you'll live well. Live whole and live free. In Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for your word today. Lord, whenever we plan something that is not in your will, stop us in our tracks. Help us, Lord, to consider like Joseph. Work within our dreams. Lord, even if it seems incredible and impossible, God, work within our dreams and bring forth the manifestation of your plan for our life. Not our will, Lord, but your will over our life. Not our way, Lord, and not what we want, Lord, but we want everything that you have for us and want for us today. So, God, we submit to your plan. We submit to your will. We say, Lord, have your way. God, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Look upon us, God, in the name of Jesus Christ. And we say, God, have your way. Hallelujah. Come on, let the church say amen. Hallelujah. Have peace with God's plan in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Let the church, hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God.
Let the church. Let the church say amen. the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen.
Hallelujah. Give the Lord some praise. Give the Lord some praise wherever you are for his plan in your life, for the purpose which he's called you for. Give him some praise right now. Hallelujah. 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 We are so thankful today. We thank God for our Pastor Carmichael's message. It was a word in season, a rhema word. Let's give the Lord another hand clap of praise. Amen, amen. And we're just so thankful for all of you today. God is good and he's worthy to be praised. We're so thankful that we are moving close to closing out this year 2020. Amen, amen. He's brought us through. He's brought us through. It may not have been in our plan the way that things turned out, but it was part of God's perfect plan, and we say yes to his will and his way. Amen, amen, and amen. So right now, we are going to invite you who are watching to give. It is giving time at Live Well Church, and we are so thankful for the opportunity to give. As you know, there are many ways that you can take part in this offering. We have Cash App. We also have livewellchurch.org, where you can go in, and you can also put it in the mail. Amen. And we are just so thankful. Or you can text it as well, 77977. Amen. And you will have the opportunity to give. We are blessed to be a blessing. Amen. And we just thank God for all of you. Your efforts, they are not in vain. They go forth to feed the hungry, to do our part. We can't do everything, but God knows we all can do a little bit. We all can do our part. Amen. So we are thankful for your giving, and we say God bless you and yours. Amen.
Let's give God a hand clap of praise. We thank the Lord and we bless him today. God is worthy. Come on, give him another hand clap. We thank the Lord. You know, I'm mindful today as we prepared our offerings, and I'm sure that you gave. You saw what you can give on online. I'm pretty sure that our deacons are putting it in the chat for the vehicles we use to give. And so we thank the Lord. And we give God glory and praise. And I want to keep in prayer today Pastor Deirdre, who is our pastor in residence. She fell on the other day, and so we want to just continue praying for her. She's okay. I spoke with her last night, and she sent a text. Nothing is broken, thank God. She went to the hospital, so we thank the Lord for her. I also want us to keep in prayer my beloved mentor and friend, the Reverend Rudolph Gibbs. He is coming through and going through some challenging times. He survived cancer, but he's going through. He just turned 89 years old on this past Wednesday, I believe. And so we thank the Lord, and we continue to pray. We continue to pray for all of you. I know it's been a tough year for many. Many have lost lives, and it's very difficult to say that that is God's ordained plan for you, that you lost your loved one. And so we don't hold that. But we do know that in your time, in your heart, in your own personal relationship, that God will reveal why that happened. It doesn't have to be today. You don't have to understand it all today. You have to understand. I don't understand why we had this pandemic. I don't understand why 300,000 lives were lost. But all I know is that what I do know is that God will bring us through. That God will make a way for us, that God will heal our wounds, that God will restore joy to those that have lost joy. I do know that. And so I encourage you to hold on. I encourage you to believe in the Christmas miracle. That is what Christmas is all about, light in darkness. And this is a dark time, but we have the light of the world. Jesus Christ is the light of the world. Amen. Come on, let's give God some praise and glory. Amen. It is well. It is well. As their Lord and Savior, you can accept Christ. You can go to our website, leave your information. We'll be glad to lead you through a prayer. If you want to make a commitment to Christ, that's what it's called, a commitment to Christ. Giving your life to Christ, knowing that you are forgiven of your sins and that God is with you. If that's you, I want you to lift your hands and say, that's me. I want to do it. I want to pray. I'm committed to Christ. I believe that Jesus is Lord. And I am forgiven of my sins, if that's you. If you're looking for a church home, we would love to be a church home for you. We're able to do that, even in these times. So we thank the Lord today. We give God praise. We thank God for his plan and peace with his plan. Shalom and rest in God's plan. For we know that God is with us. In Jesus' name, go in peace. Serve the Lord and know that it is well. God bless you, church. God bless you. Amen.